Welcome back, everyone, to our World Championship coverage. We're getting set for our next match, KT Rolster versus LGD Gaming. Let's face it, it's do or die for LGD here. So what do they need to do to turn things around, completely around, here in week two?
Well, they definitely need to do a lot, because right now it's mentality first for them, because this team, they're 0-3. They need to win all of their games, and even then, it's not in their hands. This is a team from China, LPL, that plays best of twos, and their best of two win rate isn't even that good. But their best of ones, these guys, they get down on themselves so quickly, and they become afraid. Even Godvi, the guy in the mid lane that came in here, we thought he was going to be just a great powerhouse coming in, but he's playing afraid, and he's not even picking these assassins that he's been so good at during the split. The thing with Godvi is he needs BO5 game buffers to be aggressive. He sits there and he thinks, if I misplay this, if I don't execute appropriately, that's the game. That's the game. And he doesn't want to be the guy to do that. So he's playing scared and he's not playing like the Godvi that we've seen before.
And that is so weird for Godvi, because this is a guy coming out of the LPL that has an arrogance about him. He reverse picked Dade, of all people, in the Zed matchup and beat him on both sides of it. So this is a player that had a lot of confidence coming out of the LPL and certainly has not shown it so far.
It's like, speaking of big changes, LGD is bringing in the super hot fire in the shape of Flame, which I am excited for, because I was a big fan of Flame back in Season 3 and Season 2. He was known for these being super good in the Irelia matchups, the Kennen matchups, the Jax matchups, which kind of feels... It's kind of that kind of meta we have in the top lane right now with these carry top laners. But to be fair, his summer season hasn't been too impressive. He has the stats 8-10, so I don't know what to expect from him.
Yeah, they played him once in the playoffs. He lost. To be fair, there was a part of this season where Flame was arguably the better top laner, because his Gnar especially is really good. But the rest of his champion pool just didn't seem to be as on point with the team as what Akon was. His teleports were late. He was always late to the fight.
So. Yeah, but speaking of his champion pool, they've been banning Gangplank on blue side twice for LGD, and he plays Gangplank. It's the second most played champion, and they were talking about in interviews that they want to carry top laner, like a mega carry top laner, because right now they're in a very odd spot where they can't get advantages mid and AD carry, and they think it's more top lane centric now.
Yeah, question marks in the top lane, but we also still have question marks in the jungle with TBQ.
Yeah, TBQ hasn't been having a good performance, but he also posted that he's been having flu-like symptoms on his Weibo, so I wouldn't knock him too hard for it, but it's just a huge storm of just unfortunate events here, and you can see this guy, he's trying to play his best on that stage, and I don't know if he's 100% just yet. You don't get over that stuff in just a week. So hopefully coming into today, he's in a better mindset, he's in a better health, and they can probably bring it home.
Nerves possibly playing a bit of a factor, too. We'll see if he can adjust properly. KT Rolster, though, has had their own issues to look at, especially when we look at their game against Origin last week.
I feel like the game in particular against Origin, it was the first game they were truly tested in the mid to late game. They did this wrong decision with sending Arrow into the bot lane instead of sending Someday, who was very strong in the split push, and Someday, who was very strong against Soaz, was completely kind of destroying him with his Olaf Fiora matchup, but they didn't really push this advantage. So I'm kind of looking forward to see KT Rolster more into the mid late game to see what they kind of do there.
Yeah, and also in the bot lane, we have to talk about Imp, right? This guy, he's world champion, right? But they've been playing against double TP every single game against LGD. They've run double TP and it shut down the pressure they've had in the bottom lane. So this guy, he needs to be freed up. He wants to play his own style of League of Legends, but, you know, double TP is keeping him down in the meta as well.
We mentioned that if they have any shot, they need to win all three games today, and even then, it's still not in their hands, but it's time to go down the line, starting with you, Zyrene. Predictions for this game, LGD?
I'm going with KT. I feel like LGD just aren't in the groove right now, and it's so hard because you have to win every single game, and if they don't operate in a best-of-one setting very well, and that's even more pressure on top of it, I feel like that's just going to push them down.
All right, Spawn.
I'm going to give LGD one last shot. I think that LGD as a team are one of those dynamic teams that they can go from very bad to very good quite quickly. And we've seen that through their playoff run. And I think that they need to show that now.
This team is single-handedly destroying your prediction rating. I'm just letting you know that.
That happened at MSI as well. And I still got the grand final.
Actually, you got the grand final. Yeah, we'll give you that one. All right, Yamato.
Well, I think it's very logical to just go for KT, simply because of the history of the tournament. I think this particular game will kind of decide how I feel about LGD coming into the rest of the group.
The history, well, it's been 3 days.
Time for them to leave it all on the line.
It's still history, come on.
We'll see. Let the teams battle it out, gentlemen, not us here. The teams are almost ready to head into Champs League, so we're going to head over to the caster booth. On the way, Imp tells us how, at this point, LGD's fate is not entirely in their hands.
다음은 뭐 계획은 딱히 없고 남은 경기를 잘 치러야죠. 그리고 이렇게 팀 이렇게 된 거는 다 연습을 게을리하고 기본 실력이 뒷받침이 안 되니까 이렇게 된 거라고 생각해요. 다음 계획은 남은 경기 잘 치르고 하늘이 바뀌어야죠.
Leave it to the
heavens.
No plan.
All right. Well, there you go. That was probably the most depressing thing I've heard before a game in a long time. So, on that note, let's check out the teams with a quick roster rundown. On the blue side, it is KT Rolster, of course. In the top lane, we've got Someday. In the jungle, the Immortal Score. In mid lane, Nagne, the not so immortal, but maybe we'll see him do better today. At ADC, it's Arrow. And down at support, the former SKT support, now the KT support, Peekaboo, and coach Ochang Jong.
And then facing off on the red side, struggling, leaving it up to the heavens, I think Imp said there. Top lane, Flame coming in here today, so that's new. Jungle TBQ in the mid lane, the hope for China overall, as one of the best mid laners, God V. The guy we saw in the interview, Imp and AD Carry, supported by PYL, Peel, call it what you may, coach Firefox.
Well, what can you say, guys? I mean, even LGD, even with Lord Flame, do they have any chance at all?
Okay. Well, I can say one thing. So they were talking about, you know, LGD have been having problems getting advantages on top side or bottom side of the map or even middle of the map or in the jungle of the map. But Imp, at least, he's still an extremely good individual player. He actually has the highest CS differential for AD carries at 10. He's up 12 on average. So he's been playing his old style. He's been playing aggressively. The problem is that he gets punished, and it's very quickly after 10 minutes
interesting correlation.
People all come down to the bottom lane and start to punish him.
Like, first, oh, this guy, yeah.
First teleport gets used from top laners, you know, in the first 10 minutes. Comes off cooldown around the 9 to 10 minute mark. Generally, that's when MCS starts dipping down.
All right, guys, it's time for picks and bans between KT Rolster and LGD Gaming. Kalista, Lee Sin banned out for KT, and the Azir banned out against Nagne by LGD. There's a Gangplank ban as well.
Yeah, so they actually talked about the Gangplank, LGD wanting that for Flame. Obviously, every team in the tournament probably wants Gangplank, but I was spying on Flame a little bit in solo queue earlier. And he's been playing a whole bunch of Olaf as well recently. And really just dumpstering people. Obviously, he's still climbing up the ranks.
I think actually...
That just happened. They might give Mordekaiser over to KT Rolster. They're going to take
through
it.
The band.
Arrow going to be bringing the Mord. Sick.
Yeah, we went over Gangplank is 100% win rate, but Mordekaiser is also 100% win rate. There was just that one... He's almost 100% pick ban as well. One game, he went all the way through without being picked, though.
I actually played a game with Flame in solo queue where he actually picked that Olaf, and he was pretty reckless. All he did was kept storming forward, and then allegedly his team didn't follow, so he put a couple question marks in chat. But yeah, he did show some mastery of that champion, so he could definitely whip that out. And I actually like Olaf as a top lane pick in general.
Yeah. Right now, though, there are so many options up. Darius is still up. Fiora is still up. Gnar
is
still up.
Everybody,
like, there's so many things here for the top lane. They really don't want to pick it early, unless they do want to pick it early.
Well, is it intelligent to pick a Darius where KT can just throw in a Lulu there?
I mean, they can get Lulu. They can get Gnar. They can get...
Gnar's been winning that matchup.
Even if you're confident in your Fiora play, that matchup really depends on your riposte timing, but
the Lulu just works so
well. I feel like a Lulu plus, actually you don't even have to early lock in Gnar, but if you do that you don't give much away.
I would do Lulu plus a generic pick like a jungler, maybe a support if you want to lock it in here. I think Lulu is a better pick overall, because even though Gnar convincingly wins that matchup, his win rate overall is incredibly low in his tournament. I think hovering around like the 30%, 35%. So yeah, you may win the lane, but you will not win the game overall, and that is your goal.
Someday is also a great Lulu player, so I would not be surprised at all to see that go up to the top lane. Nagne still has a lot of other options he can go with.
And it's smart from KT Rolster, right? Because one of the stronger members on LGD is Imp. He's going to get fed well. You get your own Imp mini imp next to you, use that for your fight, and then take over the world.
It's also interesting, actually. I'm wondering if LGD already knew a plan that they had in mind to play against Mordekaiser, because these were the two teams that let Mordekaiser go all the way through in group stages last week already. So KT have actually changed their priority and decided to pick it first this time around. But
I guess so.
Maybe Imp is just that confident that they've let it through multiple times and not picked it.
Well, they're going to have to deal with it this time. We'll see if the Evelynn gets locked in for TBQ. TBQ has had less average damage per game than his support, PYL.
I mean,
going kind of rough.
If he's already invisible, may as well pick Evelynn.
Too early for the memes. Oh, he hasn't even selected the champion yet, guys.
So mean.
Let's calm down here a little bit. Yes, TBQ's performance has been underwhelming, but.
Eve Alistar for LGD. The two final picks coming over to KT.
So the Evelynn pick here actually really, really heavily is going to depend on her first gank, I feel like, because it's so scary already as a jungler to go gank Mordekaiser, because you know there's a lot of pressure on you to keep the Mordekaiser down early. However, you know that the enemy team also is probably going to send their jungler down there, and it's very scary. If you get counter ganked, especially as an Evelynn early, you're squishy, and they can turn it around very quickly on you. You have to be careful.
What does speak in your favor is that Mordekaiser lanes generally just want an AFK push. Continuously shove you on their tower, depending on what support they end up picking. That leaves a very easy path from behind. Maybe if the scout is a jungler here, okay, then I'm going.
Yeah, Tristana might try and use the explosive shot early to try and deny more that.
I like it.
That early shove. But
I love this. I love this so much. Someday is going to be playing the Renekton. So we're going to have Someday's Renekton against Flames Darius. They're going to go toe to toe. No lane swaps, please. Just let it be a 1v1.
Your dreams are about to crash. It's going to be lane swap. Every time you want to see that matchup play out, and there's either jungle interference, teleports in the bot lane, or a lane swap.
Gets in the way. Yeah. Top laners just want to play against each other. It's lane swaps. That's that damn strategy. Gets in the way every time. Strategy. Why?
Well, talking about strategy, KT are definitely going for an early game composition here. Heavily, heavily focused on snowballing super early off of this Mordekaiser pick.
Oh, Anivia locked in for God V. We're going crazy.
That's what
now.
Origin used to control.
We saw Origin. We saw Origin play it a lot in terms of a kite-heavy composition. Likely that means they've scrimmed it. I mean, this pick doesn't come out of anywhere, so we can just assume that these teams have played it against each other and seen the value come out from that pick, and it actually makes a lot of sense. Early game Renekton falls off, gets kited. Mordekaiser falls off, gets kited. And just locking, if you need people to get to your Juggernaut, well, put a wall in front of them, trap them with Darius.
You know, the other thing we haven't mentioned yet is that Peekaboo is getting to play Thresh, and that is by far his best champion. He has done incredible things with this pick. KT, I mean, we'll see how the Mordekaiser works out for him, but overall, I think it's looking very solid. LGD, a lot of questions about the team, a lot of questions about the team comp. See what happens.
They fall behind, though, because we remember when we watched that Origin game, we kept talking about how, you know, Pekka's build was tier into Rod of Ages. Incredibly slow-scaling build. That's fine if the game goes slow and steady and nothing happens, but LGD, their tendencies in these games hasn't been slow and steady. They have continuously just lost
and
hard
exactly,
in the early game.
Judging by the comp that KT have drafted, they're not going to go slow and steady. They're going to look to raise the pace here and get Mordekaiser to 6, try and utilize the early dragon pressure.
I think KT just wants to finish this one as fast as they can. We'll see what happens, guys. Hit us up with your Twitter picks, hashtag KTWin or hashtag LGDWin if you believe in miracles.
Well, that's harsh.
I'm just saying what Imp said, man. I'm just quoting the players here.
Leave it to the heavens.
That's right.
Yeah.
I hope that's an accurate translation right there.
Who knows? But, I mean, there was an interview that came out with PYL, and he was saying, you know, I think our practice went the totally wrong direction after the regular season. We don't know how to play in this meta. He sounded just completely defeated, and it's tough for a team that, you know, won the LPL, that looked so good coming into this, to fall so flat. This is their last chance. If they don't win this game, they are out of contention to getting to the quarterfinals.
Yep.
Interesting summoners here. Quadruple teleport across the board. An arrow on the Mordekaiser is running exhaust. So I want to see if Imp actually realizes that. Because if you're going into a trade expecting heal versus heal, random exhaust after being already ignited, can be surprising. And then you keep your eyes on God V. He can't be forced into egg and using flash at the same time in the first like 5 minutes. And Nivea really wants to avoid that. So farm until a tier is your main priority. And that's mainly going to be TBQ trying to assist.
Yeah. And luckily for God V, Nogne has been underperforming so far here at Worlds, so these are actually two of the mid laners that have really fallen flat during the group stages.
Yeah, and I mean, while Nogne has not been the Nogne we've seen in Korea, he's still been good enough to remain relevant. And that's kind of it's like Nogne's kind of become Kuro, and Kuro's kind of become Nogne. Yeah. If you look at the mid laners from Ku and KT, it's been interesting to see.
We're going to be able to track how confident Godvi is, because the mark of a confident Anivia player usually is that they send out Q and E at the same time, because those projectiles actually overlap just at the right speed for instant slow E bonus, and then you can weave in another auto attack. So if he's played this champion a lot, that's something you see a lot. They usually practice on blue buffs. Yeah. That's where you see it first.
And the mark of a bad Anivia is throwing out Q and V at the same time and missing your Q.
Yeah,
or Q and E.
Q and E, yeah. And I want to know if he does the Peke approach, skilling wall level 4, if he goes for the actual dual approach where you're so confident you're going to hit Q that you don't even need wall and skill it at level 8.
So, LGD said they're coming in here with no plan, but obviously the plan is to avoid the Mordekaiser lane, not go for the 2v2 lane swap there, and just take away Quadra. Mirrored starts here for both teams.
Smart. Single tier rolls off the last team right now.
Well. What can you say? I'm sure we'll get the 1v1 between someday in Flame at some point. And Flame, man, one of the best top laners to ever play the game in Korea, and he just has not been able to keep that level of success up in China. It'd be great to see him bounce back at Worlds, but it'll have to be something that's proven to us.
Yeah, it does make it a lot more difficult to hit the Flame horizon in a lane swap.
Yeah, sure does.
Because it's going to take a while for him to get those CS up.
Well, that's the thing, is this guy is so good. We even have a term that we use for getting 100 CS up over your lane opponent in the top lane. They call that the Flame Horizon because he did it nearly every game for a long time. It was incredible to watch this guy.
In terms of junglers, Kobe, do you consider Evelynn actually being helped a little bit by the lane swap in the sense that her double jungler clear is so quick and she doesn't get as low as she usually does? Or does it remove too much of her gank potential overall?
Nah, I mean, I really put a lot of emphasis on Evelynn's early ganks and the amount of pressure you can put on standard lane. So even though her early jungle, you know, is pretty quick there, I definitely prefer standard lanes on an Evelynn pick because you can also snowball.
LGD with initiating that lane swap and having a Tristana that obviously count threes means they're very likely to bounce that wave for Flame to at least get him ahead, then move Imp back to the bottom. That does mean if KT leave a stray ward here and there, Imp opens up for a potential double teleport behind him. So in the next 2 minutes, that's something we'll have to track to see if that happens.
Yeah, both teams have actually mirrored wards right now pretty deep in the lane. LGD have placed one as well, and they are also timing recalls very similar fashion. Just one camp actually missed out here on the bottom side there for LGD.
Yeah, turrets taken out in top and bottom for each team. So that mirrored split push, or not split push, lane swap start.
Yeah. It stops being mirrored right now because KT is sending their bot lane back to bottom to 2v2 because they have that ward behind him. We could actually see Sunday teleport down and annihilate Imp again. Let's see if he's learned from his mistakes in the past. TBQ sneaking up in the mid lane. No.
Oh, they're going to try to go in on Nogne here, and Nogne could be in trouble. Lulu can escape from the situation pretty well. Gets stunned, though, with the Q, and TBQ actually backs away. Nogne had that ward there
the entire time. He wasn't in range to both Q and E at the same time.
I was waiting for you to go.
Kobe's pointing at me like, hey, Krembo. Too early to tell. But yeah, he wasn't obviously in Q range there. It was a decent. It's incredibly hard to stun in lane, but TBQ couldn't even predict that it was going to hit, so didn't really follow up.
Lord Flame has help.
They're pinging actually on the exact ward location. And they saw it fade, so LGD now know that ward has disappeared. They pinged exactly where it was, so they likely saw it fade next to the minions.
Hmm. Lord Flame also has honor, and he's told TBQ to get out of my lane. This is a one versus one.
TBQ goes mid, and Godby's like, no, go away, I got this. And goes top, like Flame's like, no, man, this is my big debut again. I need to win this 1v1. Some action down bot lane. PYL comes in for the knockup, but there is score right there. PYL in a ton of trouble. He is toast. He is charbroiled.
TBQ, where are you?
First blood goes to Arrow.
I talk about
TBQ.
Whenever there are champions, like Riven is one of these champions, Mordekaiser is one of these champions, whenever they're in the game, they're so heavily snowball focused that I really expect both junglers to pay attention to those lanes. And PYL actually goes aggressive in the lane without vision, without jungle support. Boom, instantly punished there from KT.
Yeah. Imp was on a track record again for good CS, and he would have gotten away with it if it wasn't for those meddling junglers.
Oh.
I like how you take it and work with it, Krepo. Yeah. Come on, give me my high. There we go. I was waiting for a high five there. He left me hanging.
At the end of the game, they're going to take off Mordekaiser's mask and find out who it really was all along.
Is that Arrow under there?
Maybe. Oh, man. It was Piglet all along. He came back to Korea.
All right. Well, back to the mid lane there. Talked about it going, you know, sort of slow and steady for Godby. He has gotten to the level 6 for Anivia, so that does make your wave control a bit easier. We'll see. This also puts a lot of emphasis on blue buff control for both these mid lane champions, because it is going to be about pushing those waves.
Oh. Also, now that the teleport is down, KT, Arrow. They don't like the tower. Tower doesn't like them. They actually do something really smart. They use teleport, I believe, or they cancel at least one teleport. Oh, it was Nagne. It wasn't actually something in the top lane. But they swap it back up to keep the turret pressure, because now TBQ is actually helping his bot lane. It probably told him, hey, jungle, I need you. KT predict this, rotate to the top lane, and just keep sieging towers.
What a tease! TBQ came in with the Krug buff also and didn't even have to attack the turret.
He's like, fine, I'm just going to stay in the jungle. I'm the jungler now.
All right.
No ganks for you.
Godby has actually done a really good job CSing here in that matchup. Not dropping too many. It is pretty rough to CS with Anivia. Flame is mid lane right now.
Yeah.
Wow, okay.
Talking about dropping CS.
Huh.
Let me help you out there, buddy.
Wanna hand him over that blue buff, I suppose.
Need to help there, pal.
Yeah.
Flame's like, I'm not.
I was trying to go over reasons that TBQ would not have gotten that auto up on the turret. And it wasn't even to not reveal himself, because he went into enough range of the turret to actually get revealed
by
the Tuesday.
He's just confirming his existence. Guys, I actually am still in
I'm here.
This game. I'm here, boys. That's it's something I bring up because it's one of the things on Evelynn that you don't ever want to give away your position if it's unnecessary, because you put pressure on the lanes just by remaining hidden. The other team has to assume that you could be there and the lanes won't go aggressive, but...
Well, TBQ, you don't need to assume. You just know.
Okay, yeah, exactly. Convenient.
It's actually an insanely good first back here for Godby. Both Tier and Catalyst Vision comes back into lane, gets all 6 CS. That is... Yeah, I'm way too obsessed with Anivia. Played like 1500 games Season 1, so... That is just the mark of a really good start to the game, so that could actually
Krepo approved.
Yeah, Krepo approved, honestly. It's a seal of approval.
Stamp of approval. Score. Gonna go after his own red buff here. Now, someday... Behind all this,
yep.
Is really far behind in CS. He's down 2 levels to Flame as well. I feel like I've seen this before. Somewhere.
Yeah, he had a little visit there, wandering around the map as well. Look at all this vision, though, that KT have placed in the red quadrant. Hmm. Not only the pink ward there by red, which will be found, but also the wards that see into the camps to see when Evelynn actually starts. Oh, it doesn't. They actually don't even find it. TBQ did not go in the brush behind red.
Huh.
It's a super deep vision, and yet again, you don't have to assume they know exactly where he is.
Yep.
KT.
That's how you handle an Evelynn. Put the wards at the camp so you can see your take.
Sweep in a miss.
Have been incredibly selfish overall here. Just with Arrow as a poach. They really have put emphasis on getting Arrow ahead, and then letting Sunday follow behind, and usually that's okay with top laners, but in a poor early game, a poor late game scaling champion like Renekton, who really needs to thrive in the early game, that can be very risky, because that gap is going to get wider and wider overall as Darius keeps scaling compared to a Renekton who kind of falls off later on. The strongest part of this matchup is like level 1 to 9.
Plus, you cannot afford to give away early dragons in trades for other objectives versus Mordekaiser. It completely changes the value that you put on early dragons, because this is going to give them a whole bunch of pressure. Straight up the bottom lane here. They're pushing so deep, this is past even the first turret here.
Well,
meanwhile, their jungler's on the other side and he can make a play.
He just missed 3 CS in a row with that dragon, though.
So
those dragon mechanics need to get a little polished.
Oh, TBQ sneaking in, but scores in that ward. TBQ gets spotted, yeah. TBQ taking a lot of damage. There's explosive cast. Someday coming in. Can he make a play here? Pops that ultimate, goes after TBQ, takes him down, and Flame in a 1v3. And even Lord Flame has to run from that one, gets a bit of a heal off the Q, but that's a double kill for Marin, and that is exactly what he needed. Godby in a lot of trouble. There we go. And if you want to beat an LGD, you got to break Smegs.
Arrow with another kill there. Honestly, that did look like LGD have no plan, and they're just kind of winging it here. TBQ decides to go over there and back up Flame, but Score, ready and waiting, inside the brush and absolutely demolishes him.
They're just not playing in sync with each other, no communication. Also, they don't really respect normal game tendencies. When your mid laner is pushed in slightly, you can always expect the other mid laner to roll quicker to assist in a potential fight. Blind face checking as Evelynn is incredibly dangerous.
DBQ and PYL getting aggressive. Flame is back as well.
Camping on the lantern.
In a lot of trouble. Oh, he got it on the lantern. I can't believe it. Actually, I totally can. That's Peekaboo.
He hooked him off
that
the lantern.
Communication.
Wow.
Oh, man. That is bot lane goals right there for the relationship between Peekaboo and Arrow. Immediate flash as he hooks him off of the lantern right before it's about to disappear.
Yep.
So thresh and so clean.
So thresh and so clean. Oh, that was beautiful.
I love seeing threshes just D-block lanterns. They're like, okay, you guys put wards on it, patch. Do you want to belly block it? Nope, hooking you off, they're flaying you off, they do whatever you can to move them.
He's having insane. Arrow looked like he was just out of luck here.
Yeah, at first you're like, PYL is going to get him under the turret. Oh, turret's gone. All right, camping.
No.
Yoink.
Oh, man. That is beautiful.
The golf clap right there for a second time around.
That is a much bigger clap than a golf clap for me. Like a pro wrestling clap. What's a loud clap? Anybody? No?
I'm looking here.
Good job with the thunder sticks.
Okay. So let's move back to the game.
When Noah says it's time to move back to the game. Yeah,
this is getting way too silly, guys. I'm sorry. I'm going to have to bring this one back around.
Keep us on track there, bud.
We're sorry to everybody.
I can't control these two. Flame and PYL coming down in the mid lane to try to push this non-existent wave back, but if it was there, they'd be pushing it. DBQ wondering about his blue buff, but KT is right there, and we're going to see KT start to throw more and more wards into that enemy junk in that jungle. That blue buff may go over to Godvi, but oh, LGD, wow, the fans. Really?
We have some power here on a couple of the carries. Godvi has a good CS, but he's building low impact items right now, so he needs to scale up. Imp still looking for that infinity edge. The problem is there's health increase on Renekton ultimate. Gragas is tanky. Lulu provides a shield for anybody who's focused, and Mordekaiser with the Thresh Lantern 2 has two additional shields. So LGD will need to rely on more than just their base damage somehow to get somebody down. It's incredibly hard to get a kill on KT, and even then, it feels as if they would use too many resources getting that single kill, but then they will fail the remaining part of the teamfight. So they're really far behind at this point of the game.
Score of the wall. Nice hit onto Imp. Imp rocket jumps away. He'll make it out. But Flash was used. Now, Flash used by Peekaboo. Went for the
Flash
for
play.
The flashy hook there.
Yeah, Flash trade right there. They got Imps down.
Yep.
See if they continue with this pressure. Pretty big spike here for Mordekaiser. Completed the Rylai's as well.
Well, someday, right onto TBQ, takes a big chunk out of him. And even though he was down in CS to Flame, he's largely caught up. And he's got two kills on top of that.
An Evelynn with zero map pressure and an Evelynn with zero vision advantage is just a terrible thing to see here.
He's got that Sightstone, but he hasn't been able to use it.
Yeah, KT, meanwhile, have both sides of the jungle just lit up. They have control of all the brush. They're always the ones getting the jump on the champion with permanent invisibility.
I mean, Evelynn jungle is such an information-reliant jungler. Not only does she works so well with hiding information by being invisible, but she also can get a lot of information that the team doesn't know that you just acquired. KT did a fantastic job playing around that. In a sense, look at those pink wards they have in the river. Four aggressive pink wards. They are not as passive as you usually see them because they have the added value that they can now actually spot TBQ as our observers are taking us through the scenic route of Summer's Rift and
continue the safari.
It is impossible for TBQ to do anything that goes unnoticed.
Yeah.
That takes away the largest part of Evelynn's kit.
Well, it really is incredible to see. I mean, KT, yeah, it is against LGD. They haven't looked very strong at Worlds, but this is a very, very tight game from KT.
I'm so surprised people. Yeah, you know, it's against
LGD. I never thought I'd be saying something like that last week. Maybe a week ago now, yeah. But before Worlds started, never would have thought I'd say something like that.
Yeah, and it is a combination of both outplays by KT as well as the early game orientation that we talked about for the draft phase for them. But man, they've just been playing it so well.
Yeah.
There's almost no moves for LGD to make because KT will see the preparation for any move a good 10 to 15 seconds ahead of time. So they can continue to take every single dragon pretty much on cooldown. They actually want the Mordekaiser to get one hit on it, real quick before he takes it.
And look at this. Gonna get that second dragon really easily too. I mean, everything in KT's favor right now.
Taking dragon control to the extra level. Not only do they take it uncontested, they actually get an extra dragon to play around with too, just to start sieging. Deep wards here in the blue quadrant too. And LGD's team comp, they just want to farm at this point in the game. Darius still wants to get stronger here to scale up. And Nivea needs so much like item power. She needs like 3 items to stay relevant. Early game, very maybe with some base damages, but the second you fall a tiny step behind, the only really solution is to farm more, and this puts LGD in such a passive position, and they haven't used any of the information TBQ has acquired for them while he wasn't ganking.
Yeah, KT are just going to gain so much gold that eventually they'll just be able to come win.
Get out of here, Drake.
Win later game fights just by smashing LGD over the head with their bags of gold.
Whoa, Imp getting smashed by a bag, and Gragas knocked up at the end of that rocket jump. Looks like he may get out, but LGD coming right back in. Score could be in a bit of trouble. Flame flashes in, doesn't get anyone. No apprehend used as far as I can see. And someday with that all just tanky enough to just barely escape. So nobody dying throughout all of that.
Peekaboo looking for that interrupt on the Tristana jump with Flay. Angles it slightly wrong.
Oh.
Second time in a row now. Incredibly hard to do, but it's not what we used to seeing from Peekaboo. Usually has impeccable mechanics once it comes to those Flays, so could have gone really ugly there. LGD still, nobody died. So that, in essence, is a win for them.
Wait, I think Dragon died.
Does that
I think
count?
We lost the Dragon during that. He was a member of the team, man. Don't disrespect
the Dragon.
As
a little KD flare,
like
can Dragon control 6 too, you know?
It's a 6-man.
We're gonna have to establish a bond with the next dragon. Give him a name so that they actually care about the next dragon.
That's what supports do with their when they have Byron buff and they have Banner of Command. You get that massive cannon minion. You start naming them because they spend a lot of time with you. You know, pushing down.
No, little Jimmy, do
Jimmy
you can do
opinion.
It.
Push down a tower.
Nope.
It supports need to get in.
But he prefers
somehow.
To be called James. Yeah.
Everybody calls
anymore.
Him Jimmy, anyways.
Well, KT, still plenty of wards, but LGD striking back. They're starting to get a lot more vision in their side of the jungle again.
Yeah, it's something we did go over last game, you know, the difficulties taking the secondary turrets. Substantially more than the outer turrets. Let's see about this blue buff. Most exciting thing that's happened.
Taken by Peekaboo.
That should never happen. That blue buff should be walled off a lot sooner so it resets, and then you can really just punish people for walking to choke points. And Nivea thrives around just choke point control because you can literally block off an entire passage and then just force people to be split from their team. So if teams respect that, you have so much zone coming out there. LGD just too far behind to really commit to that.
Yeah, as you said before, you know, it does kind of look like LGD picked up the Nivea pick very recently. And he probably hasn't had a whole bunch of time on
I mean, his
the
team is falling behind. Like, individually, Godby did fine. 160 CS here while being behind as a team. Mm-hmm. He does have the correct build. It scales slowly, and then you just have to rely on the remaining members of your team to, you know, work with that. But LGD as a whole just haven't really looked in sync at all. No communication, really, between the members.
And that's going to be a hook on a PYL. Are they going to take him out or take the turret? Neither for the moment as Someday backs away. Doesn't burn that ultimate. They don't want to use it just yet. He'll be able to heal back up pretty easily. He's got the sustain, of course, that Renekton's have.
Yeah, I mean, the further we do get into the game, too, I'm going to keep a very close eye on the item builds for the KT members because most of the damage is going to come from the choice of item path that they go for. Oh, and as we say that, the Sterk's gauge for Someday, so maybe he'll try and get in there, soak up some damage in order to deal
with it. Score. Pushes Flame away and manages to flash over the wall.
Yeah, good timing with his ultimate there, actually, to get the knockback during Flame's apprehend.
In addition to that,
unable to body slam out.
It denied the possibility for Godby to proc the second part of his Q. If you're CC, you can't proc that, obviously, so otherwise, Score would have been stunned there. So, yeah, fantastic timing on that ulti.
Yes, nice little play. And Flame continuing to struggle. He's down 20 CS. Arrow, they may have caught Imp here. Teleports coming in from both sides, but will Imp live? There's a Buster Shot used to push Arrow away. Whoa! Mordekaiser takes him, though. And Flame comes in just to die. That's a double for Arrow and Mordekaiser.
The famed Flash third Q. Oh, Peekaboo flashes the headbutt.
Flays PYL away. Doesn't get Godby. You gotta do what you gotta do. Wow, they got the ult out of PYL, but I suppose when you don't have an ADC to defend, why not?
Honestly, coming into this patch thinking, oh, we're not gonna have a very exciting time, you know, casting Mordekaiser games because he's not that exciting of a champion. The one super exciting play that he could pull off is charging up the Q to the third stack and then flashing for the auto kill, and he got it there on Impa during the travel time.
Well, Arrow's been really solid on this Mordekaiser. You know, we saw them pass over this pick earlier in the tournament, but it looks like not because they didn't know how to play it. Let's watch this one again for Imp.
Imp finds himself in these positions every time. TP behind him, TP in front of him, and a Mordekaiser right next to him.
Ew.
What do you do at this point?
Bonk! He got it while he's in the air.
Wow. Flame just way too squishy, not able to make a difference at all in that fight.
This is cruel. Just using your own team, like the enemy team members against themselves. Like,
he killed that turret with Imp's Ghost.
Actually, that's a really fun mechanic to revisit because we've seen it so many times play out where someone flashes away or dashes away into the fog of war from a melee ability, like the Darius ultimate execute. But Mordekaiser, the Q there already cast, and Imp didn't get into Fog of War, so he was still envisioned, so the cast will complete.
Right.
Yep.
And he bonks him in midair. Imp gets a mace to the face.
There's not, very rarely there is Fog of War for Imp to jump or flash into. I mean, look at the wards. If he ever goes bot to farm, there are two wards in his lane, two right next to it.
How much Fog of War is there on the map, even? LGD have to go all the way inside their base, I guess.
Pretty much. If KT has anything to say about it, there's not going to be any place for LGD to hide. And 22 minutes already, KT with their third dragon. This is just like KT playstyle to the nth degree with this dragon control. They usually don't get to do it quite so fast or quite so aggressively, but you've unleashed Super KT, man. It's dangerous.
Yeah, super early game oriented top here, and they're playing it out. They're also building a lot of damage, not only on Renekton, but the looted Zekko here from Nagne on the Lulu. Can annihilate a wave as well as look for those procs on some LGD members.
No, Bob, come back. Bob the Dragon.
Bob,
what
the first
a brave
of his
dragon
name.
He was. The first of his name.
Damn, Arrow
pusher
really
of the mid lane.
Arrow really needs to watch that How to Train Your Dragon movie a little better, because there was plenty of duration left to use Bob in multiple other sieges.
It's true. Yeah. Bob had a long life ahead of him.
I don't know how confident Bob Jr. is going to be in Arrow's patronage there.
Bob was definitely the Ned Stark of the dragon family there. Yeah, I know that, like, Targaryens had the dragon thing. Like, I know I'm getting my Game of Thrones lore a little bit. So, but he died really early, so that's why I said it. Spoiler alert, if you haven't read the first book
by
now, it's too late.
Probably too late.
Yeah. Well, I say book, but
LGD looking to pull off the red wedding here for Arrow, but he's just going to leave.
Yeah, that's like book three, man. That's book two, I think.
It's a good plan.
Yeah.
Just leave.
Just leave.
Still waiting for KT to take the dragon, then kill the Baron with the dragon, and then start sieging. Kill Imp, and then kill the Nexus with Imp's Ghost.
My preferred method, actually, when you get this deep into the game, is actually not even to take the dragon to kill Baron. I take the dragon, I send it to the bottom lane to pressure the minions and pressure the turret.
That's a good idea.
While the team goes to Baron.
Does that actually work? Is there a tether range
for
the dragon?
You can send him wherever he wants.
Wow.
Dragons
what a,
are so...
What a dragon. So loyal. They're like, well, I'm gonna die, but he believes in me.
It's like when you get to that point, with your pet where you're like, oh, you know what? I don't have to take you on a leash because I have that much trust that you'll return.
I thought you were gonna say something much darker there. I was getting worried.
I know you're on a leash, that's why I can send you into certain death.
So you trust
no,
me?
No! I was talking about the tether range.
Wow, you are a horrible person, Kobe.
What is
wrong with you, Kobe?
Jeez. He'll come back, you
Why would you say something like that, Kobe?
All right, Baron Vision Control here from KT, trying to get some deep wards. LGD, well, defending their own jungle, that's about what's left for them right now.
I mean, KT have just had control of this game from basically minute one. I expected, honestly, even with the way LGD played last week, I expected it to be a little bit closer than this.
Yeah, I mean, the Renekton lane, Bully lane, Lulu going to shove, Mordekaiser's going to shove, and they've got a Gragas for the jungle, so you expect good things, but the way that they've played it.
They dodged the most losing matchup in this match is Renekton beating up on Darius early game. They dodged that. It would actually, Flame was ahead 20 CS, he even ran mid to, even make that 24 CS in total there, but then they died to another teleport.
DBQ, a little bit of trouble. DBQ is BBQ, but Oh, come on, you have to die when I say that. Okay, explosive cast used, and one more should do it. Score gets a kill there as KT pushes up this mid lane for the moment.
Go home, TBQ, you're drunk.
Oh, that's mean.
Come on, that was a good Gragas.
Yeah, it's, come I on. Gave, I gave.
You've been,
there we go.
Well, Darius dunks people, Gragas drunks people.
Yes.
You got drunked.
Let's see if they can march on these inhibitor turrets here, because KT have not slowed down.
But you at home should drink responsibly.
Don't drink.
Put that in there, yeah.
Anyways, at any given time, KT can peel back. If they get tired of sieging or they just can't find the opening, they can really just run back to Baron right now. There's only two lone wards really defending any like guesswork to see what's happening. If they path around the top side, they can actually walk straight into Baron. LGD would be none the wiser.
Yeah. And honestly, KT do have to still be a bit careful here and keep focus in this game, because they don't want to let LGD get back in this. They will get outscaled, you know, if we go really, really far towards the end game.
In addition to that, you generally need
more.
You generally need a Baron to close out against Anivia, because her wave clear is so safe. She can put the ulti, walk back on max range, and then wait for the minions to die. Okay, if you walk in there, you know, with Bob Jr. and you have a dragon tank in the tower, maybe not. But Anivia, wave clearing versus non-Baron creeps compared to Baron creeps is such a massive difference, and you just drain your entire mana pool on a single wave. So it's definitely the hard counter to that wave clear.
Yeah, you know, not to mention just the Anivia, but also Tristana with the static shiv at this point. Imp is doing his part as well, trying to clear out the minions.
KT, I mean, this is what we saw in Korea all summer long and most of spring. Take the dragon, hang out, wait for the next dragon, take that, hang out, sometimes try to kill Flame. Not Flame, he wasn't there. But God you didn't really see much action between dragons. The score goes
action.
In. Never mind. Wow, Godby. A little bit of trouble there. Drops that ultimate. The hook doesn't land for Peekaboo. And KT is fine with that. They're not going to pursue this too aggressively. Just clear out the wards and go back. Whoa, Nagne, what are you doing?
They find an opening for LGD.
Nagne.
That was really good by PYL. He did the Q flash on Alistar. There's no response time if you don't see it coming.
Yeah.
It's a knockback CC chain. So and those moves, that's what LGD is looking for. Picks when people overly aggress. Alistar Q flash is one of the ways. Wall into stun from Anivia is one of the other ways. But Godfrey actually had a chance to kill Peekaboo earlier, but he was too afraid to take it. Just was too afraid of Lantern following up. And
you know, after last week too, oh, Someday getting a little bit caught here, stunned by Godby, tries to get away with a slice and dice. PYL comes back in again. There's a knock-up onto Peekaboo. Arrow there, largely untouched, but they need more of the team. Dragon is live. KT may not get this one. Score comes in. There's a slow on the barrel. Someday still hanging out. He's got his ultimate. They could still fight this. Someday, he's gonna jump right on TBQ. Gets pushed back right away, still holding that ult. Teleport coming in now for Nagne. They're gonna go back in. Score taken down though. Gotta be careful. Arrow still there for the moment. Gets pulled out on the lantern, and KT has to give this one up.
Interrupting the five dragon stack is really, really big here for LGD, taking this one away.
You can also see the issues with that KT has in terms of scaling with their lineup. Mordekaiser deals a lot of damage if he has the time to do so, but he's melee range, so any crowd control effect is incredibly easy to land on him. And Imp with Tristana on two items still deals decent damage here overall, so if KT don't really consolidate their efforts and work as a team, don't have that Lulu to fix a lot of those problems, then the base damages that LGD have right now are still enough to take down a couple of members.
Yeah, they definitely do get outscaled. Have to be more careful here.
Nagne was really feeling bad after week one. He knew he had played poorly. He didn't play like we saw him play in Korea all summer. And unfortunately today, you know, he makes mistakes like that, getting caught in the mid lane. And because of that, that's kind of a chain reaction to cause KT to lose that third dragon. He can't afford to do that, even against a team like LGD.
Yeah, you gotta make those switches. Even though you're in control 90% of the time, to the point where if you just show your face, people run away. That can change on a whim if they actually have enough vision to see what's going on, because gold advantages are nice, but most people at any given point in the game do win 4v1s.
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, you can still be like 70 CS ahead like Nagne is now, but can't get caught like that. KT, though, looking to bounce back. They bought four pink wards, and they're looking to set up a lot more vision on LGD's side of the map again.
Yeah, TBQ may as well disable his passive right now. Everywhere he goes, he gets spotted. Pink wards galore.
Yep. The fight over the vision leading up to Baron Pit is very real here. This is the new battlegrounds core KT. Since their Dragon Chain was interrupted, it does put a bit more pressure on getting the Baron buff for those minions that you talked about to break the siege.
They're going for it now. Is there anything LGD can do to stop that? Someday can teleport in. Nagne just harassing a bit, keeping LGD occupied. And Someday with that split push, thinking about recalling to be ready for that Baron. He may need to teleport. He will right now. Someday teleporting in as KT breaks off from the Baron, and they're going to chase LGD. P-Wild needs to be careful. Someday coming in from behind. He's going to get a huge flank onto LGD as KT suddenly has to back off, though, taking a lot of damage. Score comes in with a barrel. Imp trying to carry, gets taken down by Someday, and that is going to be nearly an ace for KT.
Someday just wrecks LGD here. Yeah. With the Nagne's going to look for the pickup here. We'll see if he finishes up this chase. He does have Luden's Echo as well.
Oh, TBQ could be in trouble. There's the E. That's going to help him get vision for a little while. Pickaboo, who's going to get it? Nagne steals the support kill away. Aw.
All right, but Someday coming in there, you can see not only the time for the teleport, but his target selection. He first goes for the Anivia, who doesn't have Flash.
Yep.
Cuts her off right into the rest of the team there with the Gragas ultimate, and then he goes for Imp, who just used Rocket Jump.
Anivia is incredibly strong, keeping people away from you, but once people actually get in that range, you have almost no answers anymore. Your movement speed is so low, generally you can't really answer that. The wall can't be cast because he was stunned. Mordekaiser actually kills Godfrey with the ultimate. Luckily for him, he doesn't spawn as a Mordekaiser, doesn't get an egg, he actually still gets the Anivia.
What a great
egg form.
Yeah, look at this. Goes right for Godfrey, then score with the Gragas ultimate, set up because Godfrey was stunned, instantly turns him into an egg. And an omelet shortly after.
Yeah, scrambled. Meanwhile, Arrow just able to walk in there.
Stun on the Imp after his cooldowns come back up.
Yep.
I wish it actually worked like that, where Mordekaiser actually gets an egg. If you do decide to kill Anivia before she spawns back up.
That would not be very useful.
I want to know if you'd be able to move it around, because normal egg, you can't
around
move.
Behind him.
Yeah.
It's dangerous.
You can actually still teleport, even in egg form. If you start the channel right before you go into egg form,
yep.
Teleport is a possibility.
Teleport.
That's what Frogger calls it.
I see.
Didn't coin that name myself. Credit where credit's due.
An XB knocked out of teleport, though. Oh, Someday caught a little bit. Gets grabbed. Tries to get away. Has to be careful there.
Yes, they can.
Okay.
Got Egg Science down. Now we're done with that one. Dragons,
this is
130
episode 2
away.
After we went over catfish yesterday.
That's right. Noodling, and now we're learning about birds today. Wild Kingdom with...
Well, noodling.
World Championship.
Really? You're going to name it noodling after you talk about sticking your hand in the hole? Why don't you use a noodle then?
No. Well, you,
anything's
you
better
can't,
than putting a limb
you can't
in there.
Feel with the noodle, though. The noodle doesn't have nerves that transmit to your brain to tell you when a catfish is biting it. Okay. You would need something like a hook on the end to know when you caught something, but that's crazy.
God,
who would catch fish like that?
That's ridiculous.
That doesn't make any sense. Just stick your hand in there.
Well, KT. let's see if KT stick their hand in there.
I think they're going to need to stick something in that base to take that inhibitor turret, that's for sure.
Pickaboo's sticking his hook in there.
Sticking his whole body in. Well, Someday is.
I think KT could benefit from just split pushing here, at least one member.
So if you go into the base and the team engages on you and you beat them in a team fight, is that called noodling KT? Trying to noodle their way into LGD's base right now. They've got the inhibitor turret.
Yeah, that tower actually fell, so nope, split push is out of the menu.
They may get this inhibitor too, the barrel for zoning, arrow zoning as well, and that's inhibitor number one going down for KT.
I mean, what does LGD do at this point? It's so incredibly hard to fight from behind with this composition other than just wave clearing. Baron completely negates that. And we saw what happened to TBQ once he like even gets even close to the fight. He just gets blown up immediately, so he can't even peel anymore.
Do what Imp said. Leave it to the heavens.
I guess so.
Let's play out your games.
I mean, all the members of that team, too, and we've been seeing interviews with them over the week. It's just there is nothing positive coming out of those guys. It's sad to see. You know, it's sad to see after how well the end of the summer season went for them to see a team. I don't know if I've ever seen a team collapse as hard as they did. Maybe, actually, I would say Ku Tigers going into IEM Kennedy's Day. That was probably the biggest collapse I've seen, but LGD is right up there, too.
And then after the return, too.
Yeah, they were a little bit better, but going from undefeated in the regular season to just getting destroyed at Katowice, that was a bit awkward. LGD, at least.
I lost track. Who is this?
Yeah. This is, it was Bob. Second of his name. This is the fourth dragon. There was another dragon that went to LGD, but he doesn't get named. He's just gone.
Oh, yeah.
Ghost Dragon. Bob, second of his name. Pusher of the mid lane. Defender of, well, really nobody.
Let's see if,
Dealer of damages.
They, LGD wait around at all, because super minions are also going to become, piling down that bottom lane.
Yeah, with the Baron buff out, we saw the Baron power play graphic right there. It's much wiser to split push. Anivia can only hold one lane at once, and the other lane will just be exposed, especially when you have
Bob. They Bob. Waited out. Tower. They successfully waited out the Baron buff, but
I mean,
Bob.
Is it called waiting out when you lose a behavior during the process?
There's not a
they're
good
still,
way.
They're still in the game.
That was one of the lower power plays that we've seen so far, mostly due to the fact that KT have taken almost everything they could from
yeah,
the map so far.
Did you see that? Did Bob, you leveled up, yeah.
Too bad, he's about to die.
Oh, well. He had a good run.
Nogne doing good work here on the top lane. Every time that minion wave comes in, and look at Godby has to pace in between mid and top, and slowly but surely, these towers are getting chipped away out. Are from, and then as bot lane masses up as well, eventually we're gonna see LGD break here, and they have really no way of countering that, because the only member that really gets in engage range is Score, and he's tanky enough that he'll just soak up enough damage for this to work. So it's an incredibly efficient way for closing from KT here.
Yeah, and any of those wards are gonna get immediately cleared. That turret goes down, another inhibitor vulnerable for LGD. TBQ steps out of the base, steps right into Peekaboo's hook. He's gonna have to burn his flash to get away from that.
Yeah, he was trying to flank around if KT commit to a 5-man siege on that inhibitor and maybe get an AoE 5-man ulti into some base
Hold
damage
on.
Resets, but...
Who are you flanking in this team? They don't even have an AD carry. They've got a giant Mordekaiser.
Oh yeah, he burned his ult too.
602 Mordekaiser. You're gonna try and flank him? You're gonna try and flank Peekaboo, Nogne, I guess?
I don't know, PYL goes in for the knockup. TBQ, where's the response from LGD here as KT still continues to poke away at that inhibitor. PYL gets grabbed again, but KT playing it safe, playing it methodically. They know they've got this game won. They don't need to pressure any more than they need to. Someday comes in to help clean up that inhibitor. There it is, Nogne. The rest of KT have two inhibitors down now, and the gold lead is enormous at this point. 15,000 gold. Yeah.
Outside of that initial pick on Nogne that then snowballed into another pick off in Dragon, KT have actually played a very immaculate, clean game, only sacrificed two deaths. Yes, LGD kind of played into that with just poor prediction. This is not the first time we've seen Imp fall in the bot lane to a couple teleports.
Right.
Whether that's his own fault or whether his jungle should have been here defending them, you can leave that in the middle. But KT, props to them for closing it out efficiently, playing to their strengths. Even though Someday was behind early, they managed to level him out, then use him as like a split push tool to put some pressure.
Yeah, I mean, I gotta say, this is definitely one of the cleaner wins that we've seen at Worlds, despite that little misstep by Nogne.
On that note, KT are also doing everything they can to more efficiently close it out. Upgrade for the Banner of Command here on Score, since they are so far ahead and they just
wow.
get through the magic damage. With two inhibitors down, though, it's pretty much written in stone.
But I mean, it's like a matter of time now.
Look at the mid lane tower, still at 60% HP, so LGD have only managed to acquire two towers.
Kind of PYL, but he's pretty tanky. A lot of damage coming in. PYL may need to use his ultimate here. Could be in trouble. Wall separates Score from the rest of the team. Could be good for LGD. Arrow over the wall, though. That's a kill for Score, and LGD on the run. Arrow unafraid to flash in there. Flame taken out after he tried to come in for the flank. That did not work out.
Yeah, Arrow flashes over at the same time Score flashes out.
I know.
Swap in!
It's like
That's
a
right,
wrestling
tag
match
team.
Tag team.
That's right, an Imp. Oh, body slammed. And Godby gonna fall down. There's the egg, there's the ace, and there's the game for KT Rolster. They will move up.
Still need to work on that I-Kit synergy though.
That's right. 3-1 so far. And there goes the Nexus. LGD falls to 0-4 in the tournament. GG for KT. What do you say? I mean, kind of what we expected coming into this, but unfortunately for LGD, things looked even more one-sided in the favor of their opponents, and KT looking a bit tighter overall, too.
Yeah, I mean, I thought maybe Imp was playing a little coy, maybe hiding something, saying they have no plan coming in here, but giving up
turns out they don't.
Yeah, I guess they really didn't.
Giving up Mordekaiser has not proven a sound strategy. He ties Gangplank now at 4-0.
Yeah.
Almost 100% pick ban.
Just makes you wonder if we could only get an insight into what is actually happening in terms of communication, because TBQ, while he did not gank, he did provide some information to his team where they can maybe deduce where the enemy jungler could be. Obviously, if you see your jungler on the other side of the map, you have to play cautious. Whether he should be there or not, you still have to respect the fact that you could be outmanned there, especially against teleports. So yep. Again, the demise of LGD is very, very often early game at the hands of multiple teleports coming in, shutting down Imp, and then there's not being any cross-map potential.
And with that, LGD is essentially out of Worlds. They've got a couple more games to play today, but they are not going to be moving on to the quarterfinals. And really an incredible story in kind of a negative way for a team that came in with a lot of people saying these guys could be contenders for the semifinals, if not the grand finals, to then go 0-5, Flame, the triumphant return wasn't so triumphant. It's tough stuff for LGD.
Yeah, for a number one seed to collapse this completely is unheard of.
Wow. I don't know. It kind of takes it out of you seeing that. Honestly, it does. I mean,
and that's why we forget that sometimes. Like we talk, you know, very, very, very dry and sec about these teams because we're just having the big picture. But in the end, like these guys are still on a stage. Like this is Worlds. Like this means the world. Like this literally means the world to them. They practice a lot, whether they did it efficiently or not. You know, in your scrims, you still build up your entire season to this point, and then to then have it crumbling down, even for Flame, getting subbed in, and you know, you hope that you can be that change. Imagine if they win, you know, suddenly morale goes up, but look,
really
pretty heartbroken there.
Not much of a difference there. Yeah, LGD taken out quite easily by KT, but KT looking like a big contender for maybe first place later. We'll have to see how that Origin game goes. Now let's check in at the analyst desk to see what they thought of that last game.
Thank you, Doa. Now with that win, LGD unfortunately can no longer make it out of groups. Very sorry, Spawn.
Unfortunately? Thank goodness for that. I do not want to see any more LGD games.
Spawn is completely off of the train. Completely off of the train.
But you have to see at least two more today.
Oh, goodness gracious me.
All right. Well, let's dissect this game. As painful as it might be for you, LGD leaving up the Mordekaiser, you would think they have some kind of plan. They bring the Anivia pick out. Is that it? Is that supposed to be the counter to Mordekaiser?
They had a plan. Was it a good plan? Like, I'm going to say no, but they technically that team should have been allowed to scale. Like, they wanted a non-interactive map for like 30 minutes of that game where they warded up Dragon, were able to control vision, and then just had this amazing kite back comp with the Tristana, with the Anivia that you can never jump on because of Darius and Alistar, but did that happen? Definitely not.
Yeah, you shouldn't be sitting on your hands, though, when you have an Evelynn for your jungle. After the lane swap is done, you have a turret that top laners are in, and they're like, oh, there's dead turret, and you just get to walk around it and come in. It's so easy to flank on it. TBQ was playing as if he wasn't an invisible jungler.
Yeah, see, I'm going to disagree there. Evelynn, sure, play proactively. TBQ, please just stay near Godvi. Like, just hold his hand, walk around the map with either Godvi or PYL, do your job that way.
You mentioned the lane swap, Zyrene. I want to get into that because Yamato, I know you have some opinions of it.
Of course,
So let's look at the way that this played out because it seemed as though LGD was coming out ahead of the game here, given that Someday was put in a pretty awful position on the tail end.
For sure. Like, there was this one big decision that was completely wrong in this swap. We see this pretty standard in a way that, like KT, right here, Arrow is going to kill the tower in a way that the wave still pushes towards him. Same thing is going to happen top lane. But the decision where KT go wrong is the decision to send Someday top lane. As I said, this lane is slow pushing towards the red side, which means he's going to be in a horrible position. The Eve is going to put pressure on him. This wave is where Someday should be, down bottom. We see Renekton now moving towards top lane. We see he's going to pass a few wards. Evelynn's going to approach this area, and he just knows he's screwed in this situation. Darius is going to take all this experience. We're going to see a scenario where Flame was level 6 and Someday was level 4 because Someday knows Evelynn's going to screw him over if he tries to CS. This is a big, big mistake, and this is pretty standard when it comes to the European lane swap, as people like to call it.
You know what's really crazy here, too, is this is actually a game that they have a TP on the Anivia, so you could also flank with the Anivia as well because they had wards down the lane, and you could make plays off of that, but we didn't see proactiveness there.
I'm going to tell you something even crazier. There was a level 6 to a level 4, and they still lost the 3v3 fight. They gave up all three kills.
Well, surprisingly, Flame was playing really safe as a level 6 Darius against a level 4 Renekton in lane. It was a very odd situation because they did seem to have set up the first 5 to 8 minutes, you know, very well for themselves. And then things started to go haywire. Renekton got back into the game. We saw the Dragons get picked up by the Mordekaiser, and they were able to put a lot of pressure around the map that LGD just didn't seem like they were able to keep up with.
But even before that, PYL got caught out warding, and this is something that you were very critical on. PYL just wandering into a river for no reason in the first three games. He did it again this game and gave up First Blood to a Mordekaiser.
Arrow just walked around him and killed him. He didn't have wards down.
Yeah. Right, I want to come back to Yamato, though. Here.
It's very important to highlight the win condition of KT's composition. It's simply because they need to snowball their lanes and play out their lanes and just do the dragon. That is the win condition. And the fact that they were behind in the top lane matchup was so detrimental for how they should have played out the game. But then that fight at Blue just sealed the deal for the entire game.
Yeah, that fight at Blue was actually kind of strange, because what happened was TBQ was standing in the brush at Blue Bruff and... Oh, sorry, not TBQ. TBQ... No, no. TBQ was standing there. No, no. Score was standing there. And he had the Wolf Spirit. And when Evelynn started walking by, because he had vision of his radius there, the Wolf Spirit actually targeted the Eve while she was in visibility, and he didn't actually have vision of her unless he had that. So it was just this certain hack, the circumstance that allowed that to happen that really messed up TBQ in that play.
But if you actually look at the play, so go back, break it down. The wave had pushed up. TBQ was there to guarantee the freeze wouldn't happen in reverse. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. However, Godvi had been shoved into his turret. The right play is to pick Flame up and go back towards your bottom lane to start securing that dragon objective. There is no reason for that shot call to even be made. You say it's circumstantial, but just give up the two waves of experience, secure your win condition back in the way of the dragon, and make sure that snowball never starts. Instead, they try and invade on a side of the map where they don't have a pushing advantage, and it just goes horribly wrong.
This is the thing I want to look at. We've seen Mordekaiser get through a few times now. Each time has come away with the win. We have yet to see a team pressure the dragon against a Mordekaiser and pick up the first couple, deny it from the Mordekaiser, and really slow down that push game. Why is that happening?
It's because of the experience advantage that Mordekaiser gives you. In the European lane swap, he has level 6 by the time your AD carry has about level 4.5, which just means that he can do it so much quicker around the 7.5 minute mark that you can't get the first one. And once the first one does happen, it just puts you so far behind. I'm expecting teams to come up with something crazy to really try and deny that first dragon.
It's also important to highlight, in the decision that they took KT by sending somebody in the top lane, it also favors Mordekaiser. He kind of becomes stronger because he's going to get that big wave that is slow pushing towards him. So, every problem got solved with this fight at the blue buff. Somebody just ended up ahead.
Well, at the end of the day, or at the beginning of the day, rather, KT starting off on the right foot, LGD, unfortunately, some dreams have been crushed. We have to take a quick break from the action, but when we return, it's NA versus Korea as TSM takes on KT Rolster. Stay with us.
My life is so beautiful.
And Flame in a 1v3. And even Lord Flame has to run from that one. Gets a bit of a heal off the Q, but that's a double kill.
Malastar's camping on the lantern.
In a lot of trouble. He got it on the lantern. I can't believe it.
He hooked him off the lantern.
Communication
to push Arrow away. Whoa! Mordekaiser takes him, though. And Flame comes in just to die. That's a double. Score comes in with a Borat barrel. Imp trying to carry. Gets taken down by Someday. And that is going to be nearly an ace. LGD falls to 0-4 in the tournament. GG for KT.